So, first, I would like to say a few words about Pierre Marco. Pierre Marco has been a very important person at some time in my career. I think I discovered his existence thanks to the wonderful series of articles Canarsa Martinez van Kostenoble, in one word, about control of degenerate equations. Then I think we start discussing mathematics in the wonderful place Cetraro. And this was the beginning of a very nice story about control of hypoelliptic equations. And thanks to your stays at IHP and the École Polytechnique, we had some nice contributions. And I also made a few stays in Rome. I was younger and I went to Rome to work. Okay, to work with Pierre Marco very seriously. And when I arrived, he said to me, okay, now it's 15, you go out and you visit Rome. Okay. And actually, it was a very good idea, very, very good idea. And thanks to Pierre Marco, I also visited several beautiful cities in Italy and somewhere else. Thanks to the GDR, we organized nice conferences. So thanks for all that, Pierre Marco. So the talk is about small-time local controllability of scalar input systems. I will define this notion later. And it mainly relies on this article, which you can find on archive. But I will need tools that are presented in other articles and that you can find on archive too. Okay, a survey about expansions for nonlinear systems and an article, algebraic article, about bounds and structure constants of whole bases. Okay, so the question we study is the small time local controllability. Okay. So, so we consider affine control systems with scalar input. The scalar input is U, okay? So OD is X0 equal F0 of X plus U F1 of X. We assume F0 at zero vanishes, F0 vanishes at zero, so that X equals zero is the solution for U equals zero. Okay, you have an equilibrium. Okay, so then the small time local controllability is defined in the following way. For any final time T, arbitrary small, for any maximal size of the control eta, there exists a radius delta such that for any point in the ball with radius delta, there exists a control U that allows to reach the point X star and is smaller than eta in an infinite norm. Okay, so it is local controllability, locally around zero, with small controls, because here the bound is arbitrarily small, and in arbitrarily small time.
U is scalar.
U is scalar, yes. In the talk, U is scalar, okay? For systems with a drift, with F0 not zero, there is no necessary and sufficient condition, which is no. The answer, okay, we don't know an algebraic necessary and sufficient condition on F0 and F0 for small time local controllability to hold. This is an open problem. Okay, it is not open if you have no drift, but it is open with a drift. Okay, and since the definition is coordinate invariant, we ask for a characterization that would be also a coordinate invariant. Okay, so an important thing to have in mind is that the small time local controllability is characterized by the brackets of the fields F0 and F1 at zero. Okay, so I'm going to explain why, thanks to this result by Krenner. So Krenner proved that systems are diffeomorphic if and only if they have isomorphic brackets at zero. Okay, so there is one sense which is easy. If you take an affine system X, you take Y, the image of X by a diffeomorphism, then you still have an affine system for Y with new fields, G0 and G1, that are the push forwards of the previous fields by the diffeomorphism, and you can compute brackets of G0 and G1, and you can compute it by the chain rule, okay? And you see that their evaluation at zero is isomorphic, and the isomorphism is the differential at zero of the diffeomorphism. Okay? Okay, so this is the easy part, but Krenner proved the reverse. If you have isomorphic brackets at zero, then the systems are diffeomorphic. So you can construct the psi. Okay? Okay, so this result by Krenner shows that the entire information about small time local controllability is inside the set of evaluations at zero of the brackets. Okay, so there exists a characterization in terms of brackets at zero. Okay, and we are looking for that. Okay, so more precisely, we are going to study obstructions. So, in the literature, there are two types of obstruction to small-time local controllability. The first one is when the system lives in a manifold, in a strict submanifold. For example, you have a system in R2 and it lives on a curve. This is the case for this system, for instance. Okay, here you see that it is a 2D system, but it lives on a 1D manifold, a curve. We will not treat this case, and the case we will treat is the case of a drift. You have a system in R2, x1 dot equal u, x2 dot equal x1 to the 2n. Forget this term for the moment. If you have just this term, you see that x2 will increase and never decrease, okay? Because the derivative is positive. So you have a drift in the dynamics, and the system evolves in a half space, okay? And if you have a perturbation which is appropriate, you still have this drift. Okay? So this is the kind of situation we will study more generally. Okay, so there were already known results before ours. The first one is due to Sussman. It is the first quadratic obstruction. Okay, so it says that if the system is small-time local controllability, then this bracket with two occurrences of F1 at zero has to be a linear combination of brackets with only one occurrence of F1, okay? That corresponds to the linearized system, okay? Then Stephanie generalized this result to the strongest obstruction at each even order. She proved that if you have small-time local controllability, then this bracket at zero with 2k occurrences of F1 has to be a combination, has to be spanned by brackets that involve less occurrences of F1. Okay? Okay, then there are other results of the same form. One conjecture by Kowski, one proved by Kowski about the second obstruction, the one following this one, and that's essentially all. So the cases that are treated are the easiest case, okay? The strongest obstruction at each order, but nevertheless, the proof that were given involved tedious computations because they use the Chenflis series that I will present later, which is not written only brackets. And so you have a series which is not only brackets. You have to reorganize terms to see appear the brackets. And so it's a good tool to prove the result when you know what you want to prove. But when you have to conjecture something, you do not see on the formula what to conjecture. Okay? So I will present another tool. So our goal today is to give a simpler proof of the known results in a unified framework to prove the one that was conjectured without proof and to extend, okay, to prove new results. And the goal is to have a unified approach on which we can easily conjecture, okay, new necessary conditions. Okay? So we'll go back to the beginning of ODEs. Okay? Okay, so there is a key tool in this study, which are formal differential equations. Okay, so to introduce formal differential equations, I need notations. So I introduce the set X of two non-commutative indeterminates, X0 and X1. Okay? Two indeterminates for polynomials. Okay? Then I introduce An of X, the vector space of polynomials of degree n. For instance, x0 to the n minus 1 x1 is a polynomial of x0 and x1 of degree n, but x0 to the n minus u x1 x0 is also 1, and they are different because x0 and x1 do not commute. Okay? Okay, so then I introduce a hat of x, the set of formal series, okay, so infinite sums of polynomials. And at this level, we do not care about convergence, okay, we are doing algebra. For instance, the logarithm defines a formal series, and this is also a very well defined formal series. We do not care about the divergence of the coefficient because this is algebra, this is formal. Okay, so the formal equation we study is this one, x0 equal x times capital X0 plus u plus times capital X1. Okay, so the solution of this ODE is a formal series valued function. For any time t, x of t is a formal series. Okay, so an infinite polynomial. Okay, at time t equals 0, the formal series is 1, and for any... And we can compute the homogeneous components by this induction relation. Okay, this is natural. Okay. So, for instance, if u equals zero, then you iterate just this part, and you find the exponential. Okay. So the formal series is the exponential of t x naught when u equals zero. When u of t equals t, you can compute the first term, but then you would need to compute the second term, the third term, and there is no nice formula. Okay. So the reason why this formal ODE is very important, this one, is because any formula obtained on the formal differential equation will allow to prove a formula that will be valid for any affine system. Okay? So this is how we are going to study any affine system. So we will have theorems that will be valid for any differential equations. Okay? Okay, so, but you need a way to go from the formal level to the level of vector fields. And this way to go is the linearization principle, called this way in the literature, but for PDE, people from PDE, it is the characteristic method. Okay, if you take an affine control system like that, you can define the zero order operator, which is the evaluation along the trajectories, and everybody knows that then you get a transport PDE. Okay, so this operator solves dL over dt equal L times transport term. Okay? Okay, so this characteristic method allows to transform a non-linear ODE into a linear PDE that we study at the level of operators, semigroups. Okay? Okay, so the strategy is we prove something for the formal ODE, we apply it in the formalism of operators, and then we deduce information about nonlinear ordinary differential equations. Okay, so we get linearity by increasing the space. Okay, so for instance, a formula that one can get for formal series is the chain series, okay, that can be obtained just by iterating this formula. Okay, so by iterating this formula, we get an explicit expression of the solution of the formal ODE as an infinite sum indexed by series, finite series of zeros and ones of coefficients times monomials of x0 and x1. Okay, and the coefficients are some integrals of products of functions that are either 1 if sigma naught is 0 or u if sigma 1 is 1. Okay? Okay, so this is the chain series. Okay, so by applying the linearization principle, we deduce a formula for any solution of an affine system with analytic vector fields. So an expression of the solution as an infinite sum of the same coefficients times a differential operator applied to the identity. Okay. So this series converges thanks to the analyticity assumption. Okay. So this is the first example of formula at the formal level that gives a formula at the real level. And it was used to prove all the previous results, but it has some drawbacks. In particular, it is not written on brackets. It is written on products. Here you have brackets of x0 and x1, you have products of x0 and x1, not brackets. And thus here you have differential operators that are not the ones associated to brackets. Okay, so it's not well designed for what we have in mind. Okay, but this is an example, but there are other formal expansions. So to present them, I need to introduce the free Lie algebra L of X. Oh, okay, it is just the smallest vector subspace of the polynomials in X0 and X1, which contains the letters and is stable by Lie bracket. Okay? Okay, so it is a Lie algebra inside the polynomials. Okay, so there are. I'll give you three different ways to express the solution of the formal ODE. The first one is due to Magnus. Magnus is here. He's here. Okay. So this formula is very nice, but because it says that X is the exponential of a formal series, and this formal series lies in the Lie algebra. In the Lie algebra, okay? Okay, this is important because contrary to the Chenflies series, the Magnus expansion gives you an object which is already a sum of formal brackets. Okay, so this is the Magnus expansion. So once you know it is in L of X, you can expand it on a basis and you get an expression like that. Okay. Another way to write the solution of the formal ODE is an infinite product proved by Sussman. So it is an infinite product indexed by a whole basis, I will explain what are whole bases later, of exponentials of the terms of the whole basis, that are brackets, okay, times coefficients. Ah, exponential. Okay. It is exactly what you think. So if you have a formal series, you... I is a formal series with, so in general, formal series are like that. Okay, this is a polynomial of degree n. This is a constant term with degree zero. If you don't have any constant term, you can compute the exponential of the formal series. Okay, it is just what you can imagine. Okay. So you need the zero order term to be zero to have a problem. Okay, it is still a formal series. You can plug a formal series in a formal series. It is still a formal series. Okay. This is algebra. You can do what you want. You don't care about convergence. Okay, so the second way to write is Sussman's infinite product. And another way that we introduced and we are going to use is a mixed expansion between both. We factorize the drift and we apply the Magnus expansion after, and we get another element which is still in the free Lie algebra, and it is the sum of brackets. Okay? So here is Sussman. Sussman, he looks like very nice in this picture, but when you read his articles, he's really less nice. They are very hard. Okay, so for any of these formal expansions, you can ask whether they converge or not for analytic vector fields, if you have a nearer estimate when you truncate. Okay, so these are questions that we studied in the first preprint, and the answer can be summarized in a tabular, but I will not... detail that. Okay, so if you are interested, go in the preprint. Okay, so thanks to our mixed expansion, we have a new approximate representation formula of the state of an affine control system. X can be up to a nearer term is the composition of two flows, the one associated to the vector field F0 and another one. The flow associated to the vector field Zm, okay, and Zm is an infinite sum of brackets of F0 and F1, okay, that involve at most m times f1, so there are order at most m in the control, okay, plus some error term. Okay, so the very nice thing with this new approximate representation formula is if you have you have x equal vector brackets at zero plus an error. Okay. Okay, so you have a correspondence direct between the state and the sum of brackets. And you can try to study this guy, hoping that you will be able to deal with the error terms. Okay, so actually, there is some work to prove that this guy converges because it's an infinite sum. And this is why we had to study the growth of the structure constants of a whole basis. Okay, this is why we had to do algebra and combinatorics in the second paper. Okay, so now that I have this approximate representation formula, I explain you what would be the unified approach if we were in an ideal world. Okay, so in an ideal world, you have x equal an infinite sum of brackets at zero with coefficients that do not depend on the vector field. Okay, called coordinate of the pseudo first kind, plus an error. So the strategy would be choose a B, an element of the basis, such that the coordinate is positive and with some coercivity. Okay? Then find a cutoff index for which this term, this error term, is negligible with respect to the coordinate. In the asymptotic, t goes to zero and u goes to zero. Okay? So then you can treat this error term. Okay, then find a subset n of the basis on which outside which the sum is negligible. Okay, let us assume that everything is possible. And then the necessary condition for STLC will be the bracket b at zero has to be spanned by the elements of n. Because here you have a part of the sum which is negligible with respect to eta b, the rest is okay, the x is negligible here, and if you don't have that, you will have a drift. You will have a positive component and errors that you can treat, and you will have a drift of x. Okay? Okay, so this would be a very nice approach if we had access to the eta b, to the coordinates. Okay? But these coordinates are in general difficult to compute. Okay, so I'm going to explain how we compute them and which basis we choose. Why we have to choose a very nice basis. Okay, so to go further, I need to speak with you about basis of the free Lie algebra. Okay, so first remark is that when you are in polynomials, you have a canonical basis. Okay, if you look polynomials of degree n in x0 and x1, and the canonical basis is given by the monomials x sigma 1, x sigma n, with any sigma in 0, 1 to the n, so it has dimension to n. For polynomials, we have canonical basis. And it's not the case at all for the free Lie algebra, which is a subspace. Okay? Okay, we have the Witt formula that gives a dimension. So for instance, the elements of the Lie algebra with length 1 is 2. You have x0 and x1. The elements of the free Lie algebra with length 2 is 1 because you have x0, bracket x0 and x1. With length 2, you have only one bracket, which is x0, x1, because if you change the order, x1, x0 is minus x0, x1. Okay, then the elements of the free Lie algebra with length 3, you can compute them. It is a dimension 2, etc. Okay, so you know the dimension, but there is no canonical basis. Okay, so the concept that was the most developed for the free Lie algebra is the concept of whole basis. Okay, so I'm going to define what is a whole basis, but it is just a way to generate something that will be for sure a basis of the free Lie algebra. Okay, it is a very deep algebra result. but I will not explain it. Okay, so I'll give you the definition. So before defining the whole set, I need to introduce BR of X, the free magma. So the free magma over X, it is just a set of parenthesized words. Okay, so for instance, X naught is the free magma. X naught X1 is inside BR of X2, but X1 X2 is also in, and they are different. We are at the set. We have no operations. We have nothing in magma. Okay, so we have this guy and this guy. These are two different parenthesized worlds that are elements of the formal brackets. Okay. Okay. So what is nice in BR of X is that you can define the concept of the left factor and the concept of the right factor. Whereas when you are at the level of the Frilly algebra, you have this guy, which is minus this guy. And thus you cannot define the concept of left factor and right factor. Okay, so you go above, and here you have. Okay? So we have to work at this level to have the concept of left and right factor that appear in the definition of the whole basis. So a whole set over X is a totally ordered subset B of the set of formal brackets that contains the letters, okay? And when you take two formal brackets and you make the bracket of these two brackets, it belongs to B if and only if both are in B. The left factor is smaller than the right factor, and either the right factor is a letter or it is not a letter, and then its left factor is smaller than B1, okay? You need one day to digest it, okay? So forget. The important thing is that you have a kind of algorithm to generate basis of the Frilly algebra, and because Vienno did the work for you, okay? Vienno proved that the evaluation of a whole set is the basis, okay? So this is a way to generate basis of the Frilly algebra. Okay, so now that we have the concept of whole basis, I'm going to explain you how we compute the coordinates of the pseudo first kind, the one that determines Z, thanks to which are not known and difficult to compute. I'm going to explain you how we compute them thanks to other coordinates called coordinates of the second kind, the ones that appear in Sussmann infinite product. Okay, so. So let me define coordinates of the second kind. So these are functionals of the time and the control, and they are defined iteratively on a whole basis. Okay? So you take a whole basis, it contains the letters. For the letter x0, you associate the functional t. For the letter x1, you associate the functional which is the primitive of u. Okay? And then when you have another element in the basis, it has a left factor and a right factor. You factorize the maximum possible left factors. You write it this way with M maximal. And then you define the functional of this new guy by induction with this formula. Okay? So it is an induction formula, but not indexed by the set of integers, but indexed by a whole basis. Okay? Okay, so these are coordinates of the second kind, and they are very nice because they are explicit and simple. Okay, and for these coordinates, Sussmann proved that the solution of the formal differential equation is equal to the infinite product of the exponentials of the element of the basis times these coordinates exactly. Okay, there is a Lazar elimination behind that I don't have time to explain. Okay, so now we know that x is at the same time exponential x dot t exponential z, and this infinite product. We know very well the xi b, we don't know very well the eta b, but we can deduce from this equality an expression of the eta b thanks to the xi b. Okay? Just you use the CBHD formula. Okay? And you obtain that the coordinates of the pseudo first kind are the coordinates of the second kind plus a polynomial of the previous one. Okay. Okay. So you have a kind of description. So at first, in the first step, you can think as if eta b was xi b. Okay. Okay. So this expression leads to another representation formula, which is x equals the sum of the psi b, which are very nice and explicit, times the fb at zero, plus the pollution that comes from this polynomial dependence, plus the same rest. Okay? And unfortunately, in general, the pollution is not negligible. We can produce systems for which the pollution is huge. It is not behind this, it is not of the same size at all. Okay? So in general, you cannot remove the pollution, but when you want to prove an obstruction, you have information, an algebraic assumption, and thanks to this algebraic assumption, you can treat the pollution. Okay? So this is how we finally have the unified approach. In the real world, x is a sum of coordinate explicit very well known, okay, times fb plus a pollution plus a rest. Then we choose a b such that the functional is signed. We choose a m such that the u to the m plus minus plus 1 is negligible. At this step, in general, we use the Galliardo-Nirenberg interpolation inequalities. Then we determine a subset n outside which the sum is negligible, and then the necessarily condition for a small time local controllability will be fb has to be spanned by the fb for b in n. Okay, so this will be complete if you can treat the pollution. So at some time you need to prove that the pollution is negligible with respect to the terms you have when this algebraic assumption is not true to get the drift. Okay? Okay, so this is the unified approach. Okay? And then there is another problem, which is that if you take the classical Hall basis known in the literature, the length compatible one, the Lindon one, in general you do not see signs, or not very far. At the beginning you have signs, and then you do not have. So the strategy fails at the first step. Okay? So to have to make this strategy work, you need a nice Hall basis, and this is why we constructed a new Hall basis. So, to construct a Hall basis, you need to define an order, because it is a totally ordered subset. And the order we introduced is this one. So we ask x1 to be the smallest element for the order, x0 to be the maximal element for the order. Choosing x0 maximal has a consequence, in particular for any b in the basis, which is not x0, you can add x0 on the right, and bracket, and this guy will always be in the basis, okay? So for each element b star in the basis, you have a branch on which you have the b zero u, okay? With x naught on the right. Okay, so this is the first axiom of our order. Then we ask, so it allows to define the notion of germ. A germ is a guy in the basis for which the right factor is not x naught. The right factor is not x naught. This is a germ. Okay, and for any germ, you have a branch, okay, which is in the basis. Okay, then you need to compare two germs. If you when you have two germs, A star and B star, and the associated branch, we say that if you have an order on the germs, like that, any two points on the branch will be ordered the same way. Okay, so this branch is before this guy is before this guy for the order, and the whole branch is before the whole branch. Okay. And the last axiom is how do we compare germs? Okay, so how do we decide this order? So first we look at the number of occurrences of x1. And if this guy has less occurrences of x1 than this guy, then it is smaller. Okay, so this is important and new. The previous basis did not have this kind of property. And it makes appear a role different played by x0 and x1. So x0 is the branch, and x1 is how you compare germs. Okay, and when they have the same number of occurrences of x1, you compare their left factors and their right factors. And by induction, you have an order. Okay, so this is this order allows to define the whole basis. And Another interest of the branch is that when you know the coordinate of the second kind here on the germ, you can deduce by the explicit formula an expression of the coordinate of the second kind on the whole branch, and you see that the sign is all the information is in the germ. Okay, if you have a sign here, you will have a sign everywhere, and conversely, if here you have no sign, you will have no sign nowhere. Okay. So all the information is in the germs. Okay, so I gave you in this slide the first elements of the new whole basis. So the one with one occurrences of X1, they have their zeros on the right. Okay, this is one branch. Then the ones with two occurrences of X1, have a germ of this form. This is related to the definition of a whole basis. If you want to create when you try to write all the guys in the whole basis for the order we proposed, you get all this family. Okay, and here you are looking at the terms which are quadratic with the control because you have two occurrences of X1. And then the coordinate of the second kind is always signed. Okay? Here you have an indication that the quadratic term will always be bad. They will always have a sign and create drifts. Okay, you can continue the guys that contain three occurrences of X1 and the ones that contain four occurrences of X1. And you can continue, but it is long, so I stopped. And there is something interesting here. You see that at the quadratic level, everybody is bad, all brackets are bad. But at the quartic level, some are bad. So those for k equal l, they have a positive coordinate. But those for k different from l, they do not seem to be bad. And actually, they are not bad. Okay. So with this nice expression, we can see signs on the coordinates of the second kind. And each time there is a sign, we can prove an obstruction with the approach I proposed to you before. Okay, so this is my last slide. To finish, I'll give you examples of conditions we can prove with the approach I presented. So the first one is the one conjectured by Koski. If the system is small-time locally controllable, then any germ, any quartic germ, WG, has to be spanned by elements of the it is not very well written, but by elements that have at most 2g minus 1 occurrences of x1. Okay, so it gives you a finite family of brackets that are susceptible to compensate WG. If WG is not in this finite dimensional space, then you it is not finite dimension. If WG is not in this finite dimensional space, then there is a drift and the system is not controllable. Okay? Okay. But actually, we can refine this condition by precising inside this space which brackets are really useful. Some of them are useless. And the first case is the refinement proved by Koski. W2, so it is a second quadratic obstruction, has to be spanned by the guys with that correspond to the linearized system, plus one branch in the cubic term. Okay, and you can continue. Okay, so we did W3, because W3 was not done. Okay, so we have a sharp list of brackets that can compensate W3. Okay, and just to convince you that the strategy is powerful, we did one bracket of order 6. So we took a bracket B, with six occurrences of X1, with a positive coordinate of the second kind, positive and not corresponding to a usual Lebesgue norm. And for this guy, we applied the strategy and we got a necessary condition on this bracket, which was not known. Okay, this is new. Okay, so to finish, in the articles, you can find refined conditions. Here I worked with the controls small in L infinity, so I worked in the asymptotic T and U goes to zero. But you can choose different norms here. You can want a system to be small time locally controllable with controls small in W1 infinite, for instance, when you don't want the control to oscillate. This is what you ask. So if you change the spaces here, you change the algebraic necessary condition, and this is done in the article. And we don't need neither analytic vector fields, because if you don't have an analytic vector field, but a field with finite regularity, you can truncate. On the truncated system, you apply what is known for analytic systems. And there is an error term between both trajectories, and this error term is of the same order as the one we dealt before, so it's okay. Okay, so finally, working with analytic vectors is nice for the proof, for conjecture, but it's not necessary. Okay, there are relating ongoing works. In particular, we are going to finish a survey about the quartic obstruction. We can split the subspace B of B star made of brackets with four occurrences of X1. You can split it into a subset on which you have positive coordinates and you have obstructions, and a subset on which any finite collection of coordinates of the second kind are simultaneously surjective. So you can split the systems into a drift part and a controllable part. Okay. Okay. So this is an ongoing work, and we have we are investigating also the multi-input case. This is more difficult with several inputs. To prove obstructions is more difficult. Okay. Thank you, and happy birthday, Pier Marco.
Some questions? Okay, Hélène, and then you.
Karina, there were also Hermes conjecture at some point about Hermes conjecture.
Hermes, okay.
Yeah, it was even and yes. The situation. Is it somewhere inside of this Sapkowski conjecture or not? Because I didn't see it all. Distinguishing odd and even cases.
So, Hermes says, he says that each at any odd order, the possibly bad terms are inside the previous ones. Then the system is small time local controllable, but it is a sufficient condition. Okay, this is a sufficient condition. Okay, it is not necessary at all. Okay, and it was improved by Sussman with the S de theta condition. It is not the same S. Okay, and okay, so it is a sufficient condition. Okay, we are looking for necessary conditions, and it is not necessary, and S de theta is not necessary neither.
No.
Yes. This is old. This is very well known.
Do you have some hope to use your construction to prove sufficient condition?
Yes. Okay. So it's difficult to have a clear idea, but. Something we are doing is, if you, for instance, you, something which is reasonable to try, okay, is to take systems for which you do not have quartic terms, for instance, okay. You take systems for which any quartic term is zero, okay. So linear plus quadratic plus cubic, okay. Then you have the expansion. Okay. Then each direction which is controlled by the linear system is controllable. Okay, because perturbations are negligible. Okay, when you have a quadratic term, we have seen it has a bad sign, so it has to be compensated. Okay, so if it is compensated by terms from the linear system, it's okay. But it is sufficient that it be, but it can also be compensated by terms from the from the cubic, okay? For instance, if you take x1 dot equal u, x2 dot equal x1, x3 dot equal x1 to the 3 plus x2 to the 2, you have more derivative here and less power here. So from the point of view of the power, this should be stronger than this. But from the point of view of the number of derivatives, this is stronger than this. And you can make this guy win against this guy. And okay, so for such kind of system, you just have to understand which are the competitions between quadratic and cubic terms, okay? And then you can prove a theorem, okay? For sufficient condition, there is the one by Sussman, and in a very, very general context, it's difficult to do better than he did, okay? Even if we have a better tool for obstructions, we are not close to doing better than he did in the general case, so without simplifying assumptions like that. So we have hope, but it's not done.
More questions? If not, another clap for the speaker.